When you watched the first season of Prime Video's hit series, The Boys, did you think, gee, what Homelander really needs is a girlfriend? After realising the depth of Vought's lies in season 1 of Prime Video's hit series, The Boys, the star-spangled psychopath known as Homelander realises just how alone he truly is.
Sometimes it's hard being superior to every single other person on the planet. It's isolating. And gods should not have to feel that kind of pain.
The recurring theme in his journey through season 2 is connection. He searches for it everywhere, in his son, the public, even in Stillwell's memory. But as everything comes crashing down around him, it is the new soup on the block who offers him everything he needs. Validation, popularity, power, and love of the most tainted and twisted variety.
Everyone I have ever loved is in the ground, and then I found you. And now neither of us has to be alone ever again. And that is the truth.
We'll be looking at Stormfront and Homelander's very different approaches to attaining public popularity, and how the brave new digital world can be used as a tool to disseminate poisonous lies under a banner of righteous truth. This is Stormfront and Homelander's Tainted Love. After discovering the existence of Ryan Butcher, Homelander's illegitimate son, at the shocking conclusion of season 1, the soup decides he would like to play daddy. For the first time in his life, Homelander gets a taste of what a family is really like.
This is nice.
But it is a half-life, a parasitic setup that only serves to torment Becca and Ryan whilst pleasing Homelander. He cannot make this work because he is unwilling to consider an experience beyond his own. How does this affect me? What am I getting from this?
Dad, please. Please don't make me jump.
Oh. Buddy. You called me Dad.
Any shred of genuine warmth his son gives him, Homelander stifles with cruelty. All he values is power, and so every conversation with Ryan is dominated by it, with not a care in the world given to his son's development beyond his super abilities.
Hey, Ryan. You want to stay in here and learn Spanish? Or you want to come outside and have some fun with your old man, huh?
All he can do is enact sitcom postcard dad gestures like buying him expensive gifts and playing catch. Catch! The mark of the negligent, corrupt father, apparently.
Peter.
What's sad is that when Homelander gets candid, honest, his son responds with empathy, the beginnings of something true.
We never play catch in the yard with a World Series ball. Truth is, I never had a dad. Or a mom.
Maybe if Homelander admitted his failings, his weaknesses, his vulnerabilities, Ryan would show him the affection he wants. But once again, Homelander's endgame rears its ugly head to stamp out the moment.
You and me were gods.
He cannot see that his pursuit of power is the very thing that bars him from meaningful connections of any kind.
I love you, son. Say it back.
I love you too.
But the best part about all of this...
Just keep him calm. Our best guess, he'll get bored and move on.
You don't know that.
After reiterating several times that Soccer Daddy Homelander is here to stay, he does exactly what Vault said he would do. He gets bored of Ryan, and he flies away. And with that, Homelander's story this season shifts gear and takes an unexpected turn.
Hey guys!
Stormfront crashes onto the scene, irritating Homelander. In their first mission together, she steps up, a little bit too much, and kills the soup terrorist, Kimiko's brother, a kill Homelander sadistically wanted for himself due to the media glory he thought he could attain. Here, Stormfront establishes herself as a force to rival the leader of the Seven, displaying incredible durability and strength, easily taking on two soups with impressive abilities all their own. Stormfront executes Kimiko's brother with glee.
I like to see the light go out.
And it seems like Homelander might just regret killing Stillwell. not born out of any sort of remorse for committing cold-blooded murder. Oh, no. It's because he no longer has a Freudian sugar mummy relationship. Obviously, the original Stillwell had a mind of her own and would challenge him, so Homie gets Doppelganger to pose as the late Vought Overseer, and this version of Stillwell is all about validating the soup at every turn.
How much shit is he supposed to take?
Everybody respects you.
She soothes him as he whines about Stormfront's successes, dressed up in lingerie entirely for his benefit.
I love you. I love you. You're the most powerful man in the whole wide world. And there's nothing that you cannot do.
But try as he might, it is a poor imitation of the woman he depended upon.
I'll tell you one thing. You wouldn't put up with this shit. One little raise of the eyebrow and you would have knocked them all back in line.
Yeah.
God, I miss that about you.
When Stillwell fails to satisfy the relentless loneliness in Homelander's heart, Doppelganger tries a new strategy. But of course, there's no one Homelander hates looking at more than himself. Bad move, Doppelganger. It also exposes the lie he believes.
I don't need everyone to love me. I don't need anyone.
To the contrary, Homelander cannot function without the validation and commitment of others, whether that be a faceless public or the people in his circle he intimidates into submission.
I don't need you!
As Stormfront's power and influence grows, Homelander makes a desperate bid to keep the rest of the Seven in line. He tortures Starlight, kicks A-Train off the Seven, and outs Maeve on live television. He does all these cruel things in a meaningless attempt to gain some control as he loses it in all other areas of his life.
This constant need to be loved by everyone is kind of pathetic, but yay!
Meanwhile, Stormfront uses Vought as a punching bag to garner favor with a disillusioned public.
Vought wants you to feel calm and safe so that you continue to buy their shitty toys and drinking their shitty energy drinks and going to see their shitty movies. But maybe we shouldn't feel so calm.
Homelander has always built his reputation upon being the Boy Scout, the goody two-shoes, but Stormfront's strategy is to play the rebel, the underdog. She's just like you, and she hates Vought. Her goal is to convince you that you both want the same thing before she makes her true play. On the set of Dawn of the Seven, it turns out Homelander has been starring in a little movie of his own. He kills a soup terrorist.
Villain. Super villain.
And guts a young boy in the process. An innocent who just happens to be there. Homelander clearly hasn't learned anything from Flight 137. Ashley points out that it was online for a total of 17 minutes, and that means forever. Homelander is about to have a crash course in digital flogging.
So I'm down a point. One and a half, two?
Nine and a half.
In his time at Vault, they have reliably been able to cover up all of his mistakes, but they have always been swimming upstream as the democratization of information on the internet has grown. As powerful as Vault are, they cannot be everywhere at once. They cannot possibly hope to contain the spread of an online clip. Homelander can't Vault his way out of this one, basically. He just might be held accountable for his actions.
These fucking ingrates realize I killed that asshole for them.
What do you think saving America fucking means anyway?
The man he murdered was a defenseless civilian, but Homelander justifies it under this all too common jingoistic lie that overpowering the defenseless is the cost of Western freedom. He is told very definitively not to get involved in the situation in any public capacity, because who knows what hell could break loose.
Yes! Yes!
Hey everyone.
Well, that didn't take long. Oh, God, no.
All right, you guys are real heroes.
It's rather satisfying that in season one, Homelander was very resistant to wishy-washy corporate jargon when he was due to give a speech at the Believe Expo, but when under pressure, he falls back on all of those buzzwords and tropes because that is all he knows how to do.
You must speak for us! You must speak for us!
He pays the price for his arrogance before his very eyes. He thought he never needed Stillwell, or Vought, or anyone, but here he learns in the most ego-destroying, humiliating way possible that without the adults to think for him, he is doomed to become a figure of hatred and ridicule. All he can do is respond like the child he is. What? Oh, it's in his head. Whilst this was a devilish tease, and we never see Homelander wreak such havoc in reality, this is just a taste of the inevitable. Homelander began fantasizing about a bloodbath because one guy flipped him the bird. You really think he's going to stop himself when all of his bridges eventually burn? This moment is a dark prophecy of what is to come in the future of the boys. It's a matter of when, not if. Homelander has failed to move with the times. We knew this all the way back in season 1 when he admitted he didn't know or understand what a Twitter is, content to leave it in the hands of the little people. As such, he is wholly unprepared for the havoc that can be wreaked upon his reputation with a simple click.
You're right. It's a little dishonest, but I'm all thumbs when it comes to that kind of stuff, so leave it to the experts.
Through the internet, truth, more so than ever before, is at the world's fingertips. But Stormfront, unlike Homelander, has managed to move on with the times. In spite of being an old soul, more on that in a bit, Stormfront is completely internet savvy.
You spent $273 million on that Saving America bullshit, and I am running circles around you with five guys on laptops churning out memes.
She can live stream. She understands the importance of memes in their ability to spread, as well as their dissemination of key ideas in seemingly harmless, easily digestible fashion.
When you see it on your uncle's Facebook page, then you know it's working.
She knows how to be down with the kids, as it were.
I'm with it. I'm hip.
With just a simple Photoshop and some politically charged memes, Stormfront can place just enough of a seed of doubt online that will suitably blossom and taint what was at one point a clear and present reveal of truth. Through the internet, lies, more so than ever before, are at the world's fingertips. And I love that Stormfront just shows Homelander these memes in one scene. She's all nonchalant, like, yeah, my guy's gonna punch these up, it's all good. And of course, the show reflects real life because that is genuinely how misinformation spreads. It really is, unfortunately, that easy. All it takes is a little push to take the truth and turn it into a matter of opinion. It works.
5 points. Oh. Yeah, people are checking boxes like patriotic and unwavering.
Homelander is desperate to be liked. He relies upon it because it's the only love he can possibly quantify. And Stormfront, amidst his crashing and burning, has offered him a lifeline, a chance to get that love back. So of course, he allows himself to be bent to her will. But who is Stormfront? If you knew nothing about Stormfront from the comics, you might think she's going to be a positive force in the show because she appears to revel in taking jabs at the corporate fakery and self-aggrandizing that Vought peddles.
You write all women as either unknowable Hitchcock bitches or Michael Bay fuck dolls. I mean, I get that a lifetime of jerking off to Transformers didn't exactly make you popular with the ladies, but a little effort would be nice. You know what I'm saying?
Starlight particularly takes a shine to her no-nonsense approach. She acts as a mirror image to Queen Maeve in Starlight's journey, who is, by comparison, completely subservient to the fabricated reality that Vought fed to the public in season 1. Although, like Maeve, Stormfront doesn't give Annie the validation she desires.
Fuck this world for confusing nice with good. Be a bitch if you want. Be whatever. Just drop the mask once in a while. Feels good. You can finally breathe.
To Stormfront, saying you're trapped in your position is just an excuse. She claims to proudly wear her heart on her sleeve, never pretending to be anything other than the genuine article.
Ironic.
Yeah, it is, Palpy, because that authenticity is really just a smokescreen to hide her true intentions. After doing some digging, Annie and the boys discover that Stormfront isn't her first soup identity.
That's her. Right there. That's Liberty.
Stormfront is Liberty, a racially motivated murderer who targeted black people and got away with it, which is, I'm ashamed to say, probably the most realistic thing about her character, her backstory providing a chilling parallel to the hatred in our own world that is given a free pass without repercussion. It's clear from this point on that Stormfront is poison, but even the uncovering of the truth isn't enough to get her to admit this openly.
Well, how do you think the world will feel when I tell them that you used to be Liberty?
Wow. You are a special kind of poison flower, huh? Going against your own people?
You mean fucking white people?
Starlight. superheroes. Don't be racist.
It is common for racists to cleverly disguise their intentions with specific wording that gets their message across without having to go the full hog just in case their sentiments come back to bite them. It allows them to move freely within a social landscape, still championing their ideals without ever being challenged. And it turns out her prejudice is something that festered a long time ago.
I will never lie to you again. I will tell you everything.
Unlike Stillwell, who pretended to be truthful but continued to lie to Homelander and destroy their trust, Stormfront doubles down and reveals all.
Your grandmother.
My daughter. Chloe, she died of Alzheimer's a few years ago.
How old are you?
I was born in 1919 in Berlin.
Aya Cash plays this scene with such vulnerability, the first time we've seen Stormfront resist playing into her obnoxious, rebellious attitude, and that makes it even more chilling when she delivers the most hateful diatribe possible. There is no fakery here. This evil is her truest self.
We are in a war for the culture. The other races are grinding us down and taking what is rightfully ours, but we can fight back.
It's interesting here that Stormfront places all of her triumphs, conceiving children, her S-tier superpowers, everything. She puts it all down to Frederick Vought before herself.
He gave me the first successful V injection. He taught me everything. And then we fell in love and he gave me a daughter. He made me. And his genius made you.
Stormfront upholds patriarchal ideals by essentially positing that she doesn't just hold power, she holds his power. For Stormfront, Homelander is a vision of Aryan perfection, Frederick Vought's dreams made tangible, a chosen one, a weapon in her great war.
And you will be the man who will lead us. You are everything that we dreamed of.
It's clear now why Stormfront is so internet savvy. What we witness Homelander going through, that difficult struggle to remain relevant, Stormfront has already gone through that long before we meet her in the series. She's long since learned to adapt, to keep certain unpalatable aspects of herself private in order to thrive in this new world.
People love what I have to say. They believe in it. They just don't like the word Nazi. That's all.
She knows exactly just how much hate she can unfurl to galvanize her acolytes, while still being able to just about keep her hands clean in the public eye. It's a balancing act public figures in our own world use to justify their most sinister opinions.
You can't win the whole country anymore. No one can. So why are you even trying?
Stormfront understands that the democratized access to information means it is no longer possible to win the hearts and minds of everyone, even within similar political leanings. The internet champions clickbait, the extreme, the tantalizing, and the sensational. She understands that 10 men fighting with passion, completely indoctrinated, are worth more than 100 who might have just casually agreed with her. As she puts it,
you don't need 50 million people to love you. You need 5 million people fucking pissed. Emotion sells. Anger sells. You have fans. I have soldiers.
Stormfront slots into Homelander's life so easily because she can give him all the things that Stillwell gave him and more. She can PR manage him, she can give him affection and sexual gratification, but crucially, she paints him as her equal. He is never stifled like a child or told he cannot do something. Stormfront wants him to be as sadistic and autonomous as humanly, inhumanly possible, and so Homelander and Stormfront embark on a sexually charged relationship as they run rampant using civilians as playthings for their power games with each other.
You okay?
Yeah, I just,
Your daughter?
Yeah. 80 years ago, she looked exactly like that. Sometimes it feels like yesterday.
I have something I want to show you.
Ryan only becomes interesting and important to Homelander again once he has a purpose for him. Now he's worth his time because he can parade him around in front of his new girlfriend.
Oh, your dad is so good in Homelander Brightest Night.
Thank you.
Mom, can I see them?
When you're old enough, we can talk about it.
Ah, right? They're PG. He can see them now. You're old enough.
You're absolutely old enough.
Together, Stormfront and Homelander undermine Becca at every turn, and she can feel her grip seemingly slipping. The only way Becca can get through to Homelander is to remind him that he became so alone because he was without a mother's love.
And I know a part of you loves him too, and that you want what's best for him, but what's best for him is to be here with me, with his mother. Please, I'm begging you, please.
It proves futile. They take Ryan and show him the truth. Homelander is so obsessed with truth, but of course he doesn't tell any truth that would make him look bad, like how Ryan was conceived. No. Only truths that would poison him against his mother. Because Homelander really doesn't give a damn about the truth or his son. He just thinks he does. He's never had a chance to understand what genuine warmth, with no strings attached, with no ulterior motives, is. His sinister treatment at the hands of Vought has become systemic. He was denied love as a child, and now he's incapable of giving it. He's not like Stormfront, who became super and enjoyed a position of luxury within Vought as the eponymous founder's wife. He is their champion just as much as he is their prisoner. Of course, that doesn't mean that his evil deeds are not his responsibility, but it makes it that touch sadder to see him perform them. Stormfront's evil was something she crafted. Homelander was twisted into a weapon, and he can never escape. But what is most astounding about all of this is that Homelander seems to start to learn how to properly, genuinely communicate with his son.
You know, I remember the first time I was in a crowd.
Probably didn't bother you.
I was terrified. All these people staring at me and reaching out, trying to grab me and egging me on to use my powers. I felt like I was drowning.
Homelander admits his weaknesses and opens up with vulnerability, and Ryan sees a new side to him, a side he actually wants to get to know.
They found me 80 miles down the I-9, crying my little eyes out.
You cry?
Yes.
Homelander respects Ryan's wishes when he gets scared in a crowd and actually flies him away. That air of toxicity, that stiff upper lip baloney pushing him off rooftops, that started to dissipate. Homelander thinks he's teaching Ryan how to be, but really the inverse is happening. Ryan is teaching Homelander how to be. If only Homelander would do the right thing and stand up against Stormfront's mantra.
That's not something we can afford. We're under attack.
We are?
Bad guys want to hurt us just because of what we look like. They want to wipe us from this earth just because of the color of our skin.
Really?
It's called white genocide.
I think this moment is interesting because his shrug says a lot. He's clearly not comfortable with the idea of teaching his son white supremacy. As wicked as Homelander is, his whole thing is that he's a populist. He's obsessed with winning over as many people as possible. He's only with Stormfront in the first place to do that, even if it's ultimately on a smaller scale than what he was used to in the pre-social media world.
This used to be a beautiful country. Remember?
Yeah!
One nation under God. Remember?
He spouts this stuff because he's found an audience. He wants things to go back, not because he wants a white America, but because it was a time before social media, before the progressive politics of this time. Basically, what he knows, what he grew up with. But it should be noted that even though he clearly doesn't care for the concept of white genocide, of white supremacy, he is, of course, endorsing these sickening views by failing to do anything to stop its virilic spread. His reasons are different to Stormfront, but that doesn't mean the same blood isn't on his hands. At the start of episode 7, we see the first-hand effect of Stormfront's poisonous rhetoric. The electric soup will have no shortage of supermen to be in her war. Homelander shrugs it all off, like it's one of those things you notice at the start of your relationship that's going to erode it later. Except, this ain't that, dude. This is a big freaking thing you should have addressed right there. It's these moments that really show how awful Homelander truly is, because deep down, he knows that what he heard was wrong, even for him, and he still does nothing in spite of his incredible power. As Starlight says,
if you jump ship and you let the asshole steer, then you're part of the problem.
Homelander fails to act against ultimate evil when it infiltrates his family and Vought and his public popularity, so in his place it is Ryan who stands up to Stormfront. When Homelander lands, the cut is meant to make us think that he's hovering above Ryan, but really he's there for Stormfront. In effect, he picks her over his son's well-being, and that is all Ryan needs to decide that he is not his father.
Come.
Ryan. Ryan. Come here.
In the end, Homelander ends up even lonelier than he was at the start. Any connection he had to anyone has slipped through his fingers. Is Stormfront dead? Maybe, maybe not. She might have gotten the Anakin Skywalker treatment at the end of episode 8, but Stormfront seems to be in a state of shock more than anything else. We know Vought likes to have its soup lab rats. Why would Stan Edgar treat her any differently? Especially after we know he hates her guts, and rightfully so. Maybe Homelander and the Seven will need to go to her for some sort of information all the way down in Vought's basement. Could she end up being like, you know, the Hannibal Lecter of the boys?
And a nice Chianti.
Well, you know, she might just regrow those limbs. She is the cockroach that just won't stay flush down the drain after all. Anything is possible when The Boys returns for season 3. Thank you for watching another Prime Video essay. If you like The Boys, then why not check out our other videos, from dissecting A-Train's celebrity athlete life, to uncovering Homelander's true nature, and even breaking down Starlight's journey as perhaps the show's only real superhero. You can catch it all here at the Amazon Prime Video UK YouTube channel.